Welcome, welcome. Is it loud enough? Hey, ladies. Let's come off. I can talk?
Yeah.
Hi. Welcome and thanks so much for coming. My name is Agnes. I work with Afros. Afros is short for African Heroes. And we're based in South Africa at the Innovation Hub, which is like a science park. Now, what a science park does is brings in everybody who innovates and helps them grow their apps or whatever program that they've developed and move forward and introduce us to people like Campus Party and give us more coverage. Now, what I want to talk about is actually how we monetize the apps that we've developed. We have like four apps. One is Moraba, and then there's another one called Haki, another one called Haki 2, and another one called Job Hunt. Moraba, which is one that I really want to focus on, is actually, if you want to play the game, is actually on your, you did, yes. So that's what Moraba does, is actually an award-winning mobile app that focuses on issues of gender-based violence for young people. And if you know, if you've read, there's a lot of violence in South Africa. So what we try to do is get young people before they become adults and ingrain in them what gender-based violence is. So that's our focus. Haki is actually just the protection of the environment. If you know, we have a lot of challenges in Africa with issues of people cutting trees because of energy. So they use it to do firewood and everything. So what we try to do with this app is to help young people to say, you need to preserve the environment and not do too much energy thing. Haki was done for the Kenyan government in the past elections, and it actually just promotes issues of human rights and tolerance to say, if there's an election and your party doesn't win, my party doesn't win, it doesn't mean we fight. You know, I just have a different opinion on what you support, but at the end of the day, we all Kenyans. So they had actually asked us to do a game to prevent the violence in the other elections that they had in 4 years ago. And the latest game that we developed is called Job Hunt, and this was supported by Rockefeller Foundation, and it's to help young people look for alternative work. What we're finding, I think it's just not in South Africa, globally, there is just no jobs. So we're saying the future work will change, and we're saying online work will become more the dominant. So you can be in Netherlands, I can be in South Africa, I can contract someone here, they do my work online, and I pay them, and that's the future work we're seeing in 10 years' time, not the usual 8 to 5. So that's Job Hunt. So what Afros does, basically, is we develop unique local content, games designed to inspire and inform youth in addressing issues that they usually face. Issues of teenage pregnancy, and that happens a lot in South Africa. Issues of drugs and alcohol abuse. Issues of gender-based violence that Moraba addresses, issues of HIV/AIDS, and generally issues that young people from 13 to 19 would face because they don't have the information. And we're saying mobile helps them look on the app, play the game, and somehow help them address those issues, as opposed to someone talking to them about those issues. And we also use the mobile platform for insight reports. Now, for Moraba, what we did, we actually have a back-end system that actually generates the reports. So when you play, like if you played with a game, I would be able to tell without knowing what you played, what your issues are. So if we go to a school, for example, a school invites us to say, you know, we want the young people to play with a game. We'd be able to go back to the school to say maybe 50% have issues of gender-based violence in this area. So we're able to give the report to the school without actually saying so-and-so has issues. So that's what this insight reports does. Yes, at the back, yeah. So to be able to tell us, you know, 50% really don't understand what gender-based violence is. 30% young girls may have esteem issues. So if a boy says this is okay, they'll just go with it without expressing their own opinion. So we give that kind of report back. That's what we call insight reports and incidents as relevant. Now, we have these apps. We've been developing apps since 2010. Going forward, you know, apps don't remain the same. You know, everything is changing. Every minute, everything is changing. So we're saying, how do we reimagine African apps, the ones that we're developing in Africa? How do we reimagine so that we can be competitive and we can be sustainable? And to reimagine that, we're saying this is Africa. Just 2 minutes of, you know, look where Netherlands is. And there's China, and there's the United States, and there's Eastern Europe, and there's India, and there's China part two, and there's Japan. That is Africa. But then we're not competitive. What's happening? We need to reimagine because everything is changing. And if we have to reimagine that, we also have to be more innovative in how we think. What issues are we addressing that can excite young people to go on the app? And we're saying, with the issues that we face on the continent, we think the apps that we are doing should be gamified, but still address the issues that we face. Yeah, those are the issues of, obviously, young people and their issues, the politics, issues of human rights, issues of environment, issues of informal business. You know, the informal business, you know, we know what that means. It means most people in Africa do informal business. So they're selling tomatoes, you know, they're selling things on the, you know, on the streets. So they don't have all these high-tech jobs. So that's, and that is huge in Africa. So we're saying if that is the market of informal business, how do we have also apps for these people that are in that space? Because they'll never see something like this. You know, they're working in rural areas and communities where there's no electricity, there's no water, there's no power. But still we're thinking they still have a phone, eh? They're there, but they have a phone. So how do we reach them so that we can help that informal business also reach for them to be more sustainable? Obviously, the issues of poverty, the issues of health, the issues of rural upliftment. Half of Africa is rural areas. It's not modern. It's still very rural. As you know, if we go back, most of it's a small percentage that is urban. Majority is rural. And rural means, I don't know if you've ever been to a rural area. My grandmother stays in a rural area. There is no water. There is no electricity. Each time I go there, I'm like, ooh, there's no water, there's no electricity. There is absolutely nothing. It's almost, they just live 100 years, I don't know. But that's our reality. But my grandmother has a phone. So half the time she can charge it on some generator and I can get in touch and say, how are you? I'm okay, you know what I mean? That is the reality. And they don't want to come to town. You know, that is just the setup. So how do we reach that? If most of our continent is rural, we need to be innovative to reach those rural people in their own setting without trying to make them change. And of course, we have the issues of education. We're saying the learning is completely different now. My children can learn on an iPad. Something I didn't, I learned on a blackboard, you know. IT caught up with me after I graduated. But what I'm saying is the new generation, it's iPad. They'll never see a blackboard. That is the current reality. So how do we also address that? And of course, the issues of culture. You know, we can never let go of our own cultures, then we are nothing. So we also address, the apps should also address issues of culture. And what we're saying is that's what Africa needs to do, is to have all this in place for this to happen. Ubuntu means, that's the only thing that's not in English. I don't know what the English version is. Ubuntu just means humanity. What is, you know, humanity, you know, do to others as you would want them to undo to you. And that's how the world will move forward. So that is what we're saying as Afros, is we need all this in place. We need leadership. We need change. Are you able to see? Let me move this way. We need games. We need imagination and creativity. We need transformation and development. We need ingenuity and invention and a mission and purpose. It's a huge thing, but something needs to happen. And of course, we're saying that, you know, most people, everybody has a phone. I'm telling you, everybody has a phone. But it's how, what is it being used for, you know? We have to imagine how that phone changes the way we do things in Africa. And the issues of challenges, as I've discussed, those are the things that we need to be addressing. A key ingredient, of course, is the imagination and how we do this. And as I've said, we need to invest in the new generation, because that is where things are going to change. The world is changing every 24/7, something happens. And we're saying if we can start with the new generation, They are the custodians of where all these things can happen. We'll be long gone, but the new generations needs to carry this forward. If I asked you if you know any 10 apps, high apps developed in Africa, would you know? I don't think so. I think everything is out there, but we actually have 10 high, most developed apps developed in Africa. But what the problem is, because we don't sustain them, what people do is then they sell to Google or whoever. So as soon as they see that your app is good, it's gone. So that sustainability or the way you're supposed to carry that legacy doesn't happen, because someone has bought it and then it becomes theirs, and suddenly it's not yours anymore because they've paid you billions. And people are doing that instead of saying, no, this is our app. Let the name remain, and people are selling their apps quickly. So some of the most 10 ones is FindEmEd, developed in Nigeria. This just helps you find the nearest doctor, the nearest clinic on your app. So you've got an issue in a rural area where there's no phone or there's no hospital, just helps you find a certain medical facility that can actually come to you or can be alerted. Pesa Calculate, developed in Kenya, just helps transactions online. So you can calculate what you want to do, make your transactions, almost like an e-commerce app. SnapSave, developed in South Africa, just shows you where you can, you know, save money and buy. No, okay, I need to buy this, compare prices, you're able to save. No, this one is too expensive, etc. Womb Drop just helps you track your items that you've bought online, where they are, what's happening, and how soon they'll arrive to you. Stuba, developed in Ghana, is just, I think, one of those social medias, group chat, you know, let's take a picture, share. That's developed in thing. Safari Tales, developed also in Kenya. Sorry, that was developed in Ghana, not Kenya. Safari Tales is the storybooks. Most of the storybooks we have, you know, your Cinderella, you know, Disney, and all that. So Safari Tales tries to change the story, have young people also read African stories and online, and help them have that kind of perspective. That's also developed in Kenya. Slim Trader, developed in Uganda, Kenya, Nigeria, and South Africa. In these countries, you're able to collaborate in terms of how you perform your e-commerce transactions as well, buying, paying for goods via SMS, WAP, etc. M-Farm, developed in Kenya. It gives the farmer update information on how much your crop's costing so they can be able to trade more effectively. Now, remember, my first talk was about our apps. Our apps, of course, cannot compete with these apps, because for us, it's social impact. We want to change how young people think. So because we're a social enterprise, our passion goes to, we want to see a generation that is more human. So we can't compete with all these more practical apps. I mean, I don't think anybody wants to invest in something that says, oh, we want a different youth. That's just how the world is. But at the same time, we also need to think about how we monetize and how we move forward as an organization and still impact youth, but still be able to monetize. A big challenge, and that's what the challenge is all about. How do we do that? You know, because everything can't be about profit. Because the more everything is about profit, the more humanity goes. That's what we believe. And the more issues are not addressed, because everybody's just about profit, profit, profit. And no one is thinking about, what about, you know, the humanity of it? Where is it? You know, what type of generation do we want? Do we want the future generation to be so profit-driven that they're not humane enough or don't have just the basic social skills of what it means to be a human being? So that's the dilemma we find ourselves in this space, because we are in a space where it's all about money, 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 and yet you can't survive without money. Yeah. So we're saying Africa needs to rebirth how all this happens. It's a challenge. I don't have the answers, and I think that's why we go around networking, discussing, exchanging ideas. How do we move to that space of, yes, we want to develop apps, but how do we do that so that it makes sense for people that are actually also accessing it? And as I said, I think for Africa to give birth to this, we need innovative apps to position youth for success. And I'm a strong believer. I know someone challenged me to say, no, but apps should also be for people older. But I'm saying, yeah, but the future generation that's actually online is the youth. And that's the market. And that's who we should be targeting so that we have a new generation that is more organized and more focused. And the apps should still be able to make money. Not huge profits that are almost like insane and sort of ridiculous, but just money to sustain the work so the work can carry on. And of course, the strong political will. Remember, I had that picture of the leadership and vision and purpose. We still need governments to support what's happening. I mean, I landed, and this is my first time in Netherlands. I landed and the taxi driver was telling me that this car is electric. Electric car. I've never been an electric car. It's always fuel. It's always diesel. And it tells me, no, this is electric car. And it's so fancy. It's like, wow. And he says, that's the future for Netherlands. But obviously that wouldn't have happened in his space. The government had to sort of get in, make political will, and start making the changes. And for apps in Africa, that is what's needed. Political will that says, this is priority and we need to invest in it and move forward. And of course, the private sector also coming in to support. How do we monetize? Of course, our games currently have only like 57,000 downloads. And most of the time, private sector will tell you, unless you've got more than 100,000, we can't talk, we can't advertise. So the challenge of increasing the user base so that, you know, people can advertise on our apps. And of course, developing key global partnerships. You know, who else is there who thinks like us, who thinks the mission makes sense, that we need to focus on the youth in Africa to address those issues. And of course, the capacity. We cannot do it ourselves. Sometimes the capacity, we know our own weakness is in marketing. The issue of marketing the app is not so great. You know, we focus so much on the concept, the development, but to market and sell it, we don't have that capacity. And I think the partnerships to do that would be good. And this is just probably how some ideas on how Moraba, especially because it's already out there, can be monetized. You know, we look at the content development, the distribution, and enhance it. And that's what the challenge is about. How do we enhance the game so that it's more attractive to other users? And of course, the user remains free. We have donation button. That just explains the diagram before. Or do we focus on the report that I was saying at the back end? We have the report. Do we focus on the client just wanting the report of the back end and we focus on monetizing that? That's the data derived directly from the product game, which creates its own value. How do we do that? That is just part of the thinking process. And why do we use technology designed for London and Los Angeles when we live in Nairobi and New Delhi? What I'm trying to say here is the challenges we face completely different from the challenges you would face. They may be global, but different content needs to be done to address the issues at hand. And this is just to show that the market is there. By 2012, we had 7.35 million people on mobile. That's a lot. So, yeah, just mobile. Just mobile, no internet, just mobile. Just mobile, yeah. Just like they have remember what I was saying about my grandmother? She has a phone. She may not read, but she can just say, I'm calling, hi. But they have a phone. What you can do with it means the potential is there. That's 450 million youth on mobile. So that's our market. So the potential is there. It's just the how we creatively think about it. How do we reach them? What content do we give them? Is it, you know, is it meaningful? Does it appeal to them? And those are the things that we need to focus on. And of course, we like to be in second place. So yes, that is end of my presentation, I can change the world. And he's thinking, they can change the world. It's just how we reach them and how we engage with them. And as I was saying, for us, it's just this is what, imagination is the key source. We have to be so creative, so innovative, so imaginative to reach that 450 million. Thank you. Thank you so much for listening. Thank you for coming. I've seen you before. You look so familiar. I'll talk to you. Thank you. That's it. Thank you so much.
Yes? Okay, I repeat the question. The app, it seemed... the Moraba app. It seemed more for smaller children because of the design and everything, while the topic was, serious gender topics. So are you working on changing that, maybe to make it more interesting? I could not really imagine that it was exciting enough for teens to play it, too. Yeah.
Yeah, yes. For Moraba Life, because now what we want to do is actually change the game to be called Moraba Life, so it can have more issues that young people face. When we developed Moraba, we're actually supported by the United Nations Women Program, because they're very keen about issues of gender-based violence in the country. So they provided us with those questions, and because it's grant funding, they actually specify that you need to stay in this scope. So all the questions you're going to ask on your app should be questions that address their own mandate. That's why you find it like so heavy, you know. And we try to gamify it, because it's like a quiz. You ask, you know, you play, you ask three questions. If you're wrong, it sort of corrects you. Now, for Moraba Life, we're saying we can actually gamify it and make it more targeted to the audience, because now it's not about the UN Women, and we've gone back to them and they've said, no, we can do what we want now, because the grant funding is gone, and we can play with the game. Because when you get grant funding, it's like taxpayers' money, it's donors' money, so you can't really deviate. They'll tell you, no, address our issues, stick to this, you can't be too far from this. So we tried as much as possible, and you're right, if you are playing it by yourself without a face-to-face, it is quite heavy. So what we try to do is we go in schools. So as they're playing, there's a user engagement officer, you know, who talks to the game. Then it's more interesting. Then it's not too. And I think that's also been a challenge of why the download has been 57,000 instead of, by now we should be 1 million, I think. Yeah. But there is thinking around changing in the Moraba Life. Is to change everything to make it more engaging, yeah.
Could you tell us something more about when it is with the school-based approach,
yeah.
The app, how it works, do schools come to you?
So it's both. Sometimes we go to schools and, you know, try to get a partnership going. Sometimes they approach us to say, please come into a school, and most of the schools are usually in location. A location is, you know, not your suburbs. So a location is not your suburbs, so it's, you know, the formerly disadvantaged schools. So the headmaster or principal will say, there's a lot of violence in my school, you know, the violence is going up, please come in so that they can, you know, they can engage with the game, because if we talk, usually young people don't listen to talk. So maybe something like, you know, engage, play the game. That's what would happen. So we would go in a school. They would give us the students, maybe 30 students. We'll play the game. First of all, we talk about issues of gender violence, relationships. So we don't just say, get into the game now. We have a conversation. What do you think as a young boy, as a teenager, what is violence mean to you? What does a girl mean to you? You know, if a girl is wearing a short skirt, you know, what ideas are you getting? You know what I mean? So we can get that kind of mindset. You know, is it cultural? You know, you think it's okay if a girl is wearing a short skirt to, you know, hit her backside, or just think. So we try to change those narratives. So we have a conversation for 30 minutes. So once we have that, then we can say, okay, let's play a game. So we don't judge, we don't condemn, we don't say, no, it's right, no, it's wrong. We say, let's play the game. So that game now challenges the young man or the young woman who may have self-esteem to say, oh, if a boy forces sex on me, it's okay because he's my boyfriend. No, it's not okay if you're not happy with it. So we try to correct, have the conversation. We don't correct the thinking. Then we play the game. So if we play the game, as I said, we have a back system where we can now have the report for the principal to say, okay, 50%, 40% think this is okay. So maybe in your life orientation program, you need to pay attention to these issues. You know, you need to see how you address them. You need a social worker. Maybe there are issues at home and all that. I'll give you an example. During the 16 days of activism to end violence against women, I don't know if you have it here, between 23 November to 10 December, it's a global movement. That's when just everybody focuses on that. We were invited to a rural area right in Eastern Cape, right in the rural meaning no electricity, no water, right in the mountains. And we were actually commissioned by Telkom. So Telkom is like your telephone companies. They've sponsored young girls to do mathematics and science. And they were discovering that there was a lot of dropout. These girls were not completing. Not because they were failing. You know, the marks are good, but they're just dropping out. The marks are very good. They're above 70%, 90%. So it's not an issue of academic. They're just dropping out. By the time they get to grade 12, grade 11, they don't want to do the maths and science anymore. Why? So they said, you know, go and investigate using the game. So we went with the game, as usual, you know, we did the 30 minutes, let's have a chat, let's have a talk. It's only girls. So it's a girls' school there, so there are no boys. And what came out from those girls, so it's not that they can't perform. Academically, they're very sharp. But what happened was, of course, they were being molested at home by either an uncle or a relative or whatever. You see what I mean? So those psychological issues make them not want to go to school. And they were thinking it's okay, culturally it's okay. You see what I mean? So there's that kind of, that needs to be corrected. And as we're having conversations, we're saying, no, culturally it's not correct. There is no culture, whether your uncle tells you it's okay for your uncle to have sex with a 15-year-old, it is not okay. You need to report it. You see what I mean? So because they're in a space where they don't have this information, they think it's okay. You see what I mean? So that conversation helps before they play the game. So when they play the game, they're able to see that, no, actually, it is not okay. You know what I mean? I can report at social services. I can report to the police. I can report to a teacher. I have an outlet. So that conversation, when you get in a school, it helps because it breaks the barrier. It opens up the confidence where young people can talk to you to say, actually, you know, I need to speak to you. I have an issue. How do I address this? So that's what happened. So we gave this report to Telkom to say, academically, they're very good. So it's obviously the environment they're in. So you either take them to a different school, or you have social workers be more involved in that school, or you talk to the parents and teachers or guardians, whoever's looking after them, so get more involved. So don't just pay school fees, get involved in seeing what's happening to these young girls so they can finish and, you know, get to university and all. So that's what we do. Questions? Clear?
When you talk about Africa, people try to have a stereotype, but yeah. Probably, as you can see, in countries, and in each country, is a disparity. So you have a certain amount of population that has access to internet, water, electricity, while a part of the population doesn't have. How do you see, a lot of difference between the population? They're talking about girls and social ideas. Is there a lot of difference between the sector of society that each girls come from? Does it change a lot, or those ideas is general in the society?
From research, what we found from research, definitely in Africa, doesn't matter whether it's east, west, whatever, girls are marginalized. You know, you don't have the same access as your boy child would have to education. You know, people would invest more in a boy child than the girl child. So wherever you go, it's almost the same. That's what we've noticed. So in terms of access to school and whatever, it's changing because now with most organizations and most governments are trying to change that. But it's still very, very slow. That one I can assure you, very slow. In terms of in fallout from school, if the parents don't have money for the child to go to school, you got boy child and girl child, the girl child would probably stay at home because why? They think, oh, you get married and you'll be supported, while the boy child, you know, needs to carry this. So those stereotypes across the continent, I think they're still there. It's not just in South Africa. I used to work for the United Nations before I started this, so I know from research, and I used to focus a lot on gender issues, so that still remains. Still 21st century, still an issue. Very far to go. And in terms of, that's why we even say, for learning, and because everybody's got a mobile, so maybe the reach becomes easy if you can reach people through the mobile, because wherever you are, people have a mobile phone. So how do we start imagining, how do we innovate so that we can change that kind of narrative? I don't have answered your question, sorry.
Just to finish, I'm from Brazil, and I can see some few similarities because you have some place where people have access to smartphones and to internet, but they don't have access to basic
water.
Basic needs.
It's a
good way to reach them through mobile phones. Mm. And although they have access to internet, what they look for is not for information.
Exactly.
So sometimes people has some doubts about sexuality or how to use condom or avoiding pregnancy, but they have this smartphone on the hand, but they don't know how to use or they don't use it to find information. And sometimes the information they found is not the right one.
Yeah.
Because you can see a lot of wrong information on the internet.
Yeah, exactly.
So it's a wonderful idea to reach them through internet and smartphones.
Yeah. And that's what I was saying about the political will. Because we're trying to say, yes, you have, I mean, my grandmother stays in a village. No water, no electricity. I mean, to get there is like a mission, but I have to go and see her. But I can phone her. You know what I mean? She can pick up the phone and say, hello, you know, how are you, you know. But, as you are saying, if I needed to send money to her, it's still the old route. And yet, if she could just use that phone to say, I can access this money, go to the post office and get my money, it would be easy. So, the same challenges in Africa, we're not really being imaginative and resourceful in how we use and reach people in rural areas using the mobile phone. And that is imaginative. This is what we need. The imagination, how do we, you know, this is so powerful, but we're not there. And when I talked about the electric car, it's also the government to get involved, because the government is also like sits there, they're just worried about politics and elections, you know. They're not worried about how do they get involved to change this narrative. So that political will, the imagination, the constant activism, people just pushing and pushing, is I think what's needed. Otherwise, it won't happen. Okay, find out. Yeah, so you are right. You know, Brazil, same issues. We just need to be, I don't know, think big. See what she sees in that mirror. You know, I can do this. I'm hopeful that maybe the new generation is the one that's going to push us there. Eric?
To popularize the app, have you thought about maybe bringing in role models, for example, endorsing the app, maybe to reach the youth, that would help as well?
That is a good idea. Because I think also, role models that I want to be paid. So that narrative needs to change, because these role models also now think, I endorse this, you pay me. That's what I mean. So where do you find a role model that just says, this is for social good? I don't have to be paid, but I want to impact lives of young people. And it's so hard to find those role models these days. You know what I mean? The young people look out to this singer or actor, but they've also got this thing that they're in Hollywood and, you know, I need to be paid, royalties, how much, you know what I mean? So that is also becomes a challenge. So if you don't have people that think for social good in big numbers, then the people who think for profit will always sort of slow the process of where we think young people should be going with these issues.
Could you tell us something more about how it started? With who are the persons, or where did it start?
So how it started was, me and my partner, we're single. I have two boys, and my partner has three kids, two girls and one boy. They were always playing games, not always on the phone, you know. You want to talk to them, you want to eat supper, they're on the phone. And you try to see what games they're playing, meaningless games. You know, kill, shoot, meaningless, you know what I mean? I mean, after you've played the game, you know, it's a meaningless game. I'm not judging as a young person, but the games are meaningless, you know what I mean? And we're thinking, oh, okay, what if we can develop games that, yes, they can play the meaningless games, but maybe also push for games that educate them, gives them information. So that's where the excitement came from. And because we came from a background of working in the UN for so long, we were like, okay, and then these are the global issues. How do we change that these young people also get to know about these issues whilst they're playing? So that's how the game started.
Is the app also downloaded in other African countries, or?
What we discovered with Moraba, it was actually downloaded globally, you know. So it wasn't just in Africa; it was actually outside as well. So that's why we decided, you know, actually, the issues are the same everywhere. Maybe the extent differs, but the issues of what young people face between 13 and 19 almost the same.
And in which countries are they more popular, or which countries were you were surprised that they were downloaded?
We're actually surprised that it was downloaded more in India. Yeah. So then it also gave us feedback to say, actually, issues same everywhere. So we just need to see, as I said, maybe our marketing, because we're so involved in the content and app development, maybe the marketing is what we need to focus on, you know. How do we sell this more? If these issues affect everybody, how do we sell it more so that we can monetize? Maybe we can get some people advertising on the app.
And if they download the game, a girl or a boy, how do they play it? Do they play it one time very intensively, or is it something that they will continue to do over the months?
They play it one time continuously, and then the repeat doesn't happen. You see what I mean? So that's why now moving forward with the challenge that we wanted to do was, we make it more rubber life so that the issues are more varied and the comeback becomes more. And then have a feature as well in the game where you can play with me. You see what I mean? We compete. So instead of playing by yourself, we don't know, maybe invite your friends to say, guys, there's this issue. Let's play and see how we're doing this. But that's the future now, thinking how do we make it more exciting.
And when they play it more times, what do you see in the
an improvement? Yes, we see an improvement. So if you had certain mindset about what gender-based violence is, we see the change, because you're more confident in saying, no, actually this is wrong, you know, this is right. So you see a pattern changing. Yeah.
I was wondering, like, if you know when you get new downloads, like if it's kids who find the games themselves and want to play it, or if it's like their parents who like, please try this and see what you think, or if it's teachers, or how do they find like the game?
If it's teachers, like if you go to a school, we say please encourage it in your life orientation. So we won't know whether it's the teacher, because they've been saying, if you don't want to hear about this, play the game. So we're not able to tell that. We're just able to say someone downloaded this and their age group is. So that kind of feature we don't have to say, is it the parents that encourage them, or is it themselves that just said, I want to play the game? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, I was just wondering if you maybe like asked a lot of people, like if you made some sort of research
we do.
If
we go to schools, we try to tell the teachers, please ask the young people, and when they go to their communities as well, you know, they go back home in the communities where the young people are not in school, tell them to also play the game. So we try to do word of mouth.
But But so the people in other countries who used it, you don't know like how
no,
they...
No, we don't. What we've been trying to do, if we have money, like we try to ask countries to say, can we come there and localize it, maybe in your own language or the issues? Yeah, so we try to localize for each country, yeah. But because the money that we got from the UN Women was limited, we could only focus on, yeah. But money permitting, definitely would want to go localize, put it in everybody's language and, you know.
And so even if you don't, because you mentioned like when you do it in schools, you have a discussion first.
Then we'll train those people, you know.
Yeah, but I was thinking like if you don't do it in school, like it still works good, right?
Yes. We're still able to do that. But for schools, we'd want to be there because of, you know, we just want to understand what's going on. Yeah. Yeah. For other people, yes. But for schools, it's nice to, you know, because the reports we're getting, the violence in schools, it's getting worse. You know, you find young people, take a knife at, it's just, it's ridiculous. So we'd want to be talking to government, and the political, we were saying, you know, we've been talking to government to say, look, this is a free app. All we want to do is give us access to schools, you know, because young people are not allowed to use phones in schools. You know, they're not allowed to bring phones at school. So we're saying, after school, just allow us to come in, allow them, you know, even if we brought our own iPads, but just give us that 2 hours, you know what I mean? But even that is a mission. You know what I mean? It's like government is like, okay, we give you 2 schools. I mean, there are more than 700 schools. I know exactly. So that kind of frustration, if the government can't even see that this can help, I don't know. But we keep trying. We don't give up. We keep knocking.
Yeah, I love the idea. Thanks.
And when you do the next version, are you also thinking about maybe to have a competition between teachers and students about the subject?
That would be nice, that would be good.
I can imagine they think, they really don't know what's happening.
That would be good. That would be good. We want to make the next version very exciting. And, you know, but we're only 6 of us in the office, 6. So the reach, the thinking, is yeah.
Yeah, my son at his school, he had they had a program about bullying, but they had some. It was kind of a movie, and there were at 6 points you could have a different choice, and there was a different consequence of it.
Yeah.
And it was really
a movie.
Yes,
on
it was really
yes,
and you could redo the game in the classroom for 15 times, and it would be different with different choices and would be the consequence.
Yeah. You must share that with me. I must give you my card.
I will.
Yes. Because the issue of bullying now has become like cyberbullying. So the bullying we had where it was 1-to-1 is gone. Now it's like 1,000 people can bully you just using, you know, mobile. So how do we also address that? So issues are just like changing and changing. So the more creative we get, the more impact we can make. So that's the challenge we have. And then the challenge kickoff is obviously to deal with these issues. We want to focus on Moraba, as you were saying. Make it more creative, make it more imaginative, make it more appealing to young people that they can actually go and download the game. And that is the challenge we wanted to kick off. You know, how do we make Moraba to Moraba life and have the issues of alcohol and drug abuse, bullying, teenage pregnancy, which is high in South Africa, HIV AIDS as well. The rates apparently have started going up. They've gone down, they're going up. So we make it Moraba life. How do we do that? That is the challenge that I had for this presentation. So I don't know if everybody wants to be part of that. How do we make it more exciting? Know that. Thank you so much for listening. Thank you for the feedback.